So welcome to this Medace INI-CET Prepathon series, wherein today we are having a live session on the subject psychiatry. It's observed that particularly the minor subjects like psychiatry, dermatology, so many of the students kind of brush off thinking that it's a minor subject, but over a period of time, years, it is seen that there are certain topics so that are often repeated and high-yield, and it fetches you definitive marks. Okay, so today we are going to discuss about few of the past year questions, and along with we'll also discuss some of the important topics and additional points with regard to each of those topics. Okay, so these are all the high-yield topics that I've identified based on previous year questions. So almost psychopharmacology, it's about 40% of the questions were based on psychopharmacology. So that's a one topic you can't ignore. Then substance use disorders. So every other INICET exam features one or the other definite substance use, be it alcohol, cannabis, cocaine, and so on. And there is one question on dementias, various dementias. Of late, it has been seen that even psychopathology, that is the signs and symptoms, so are also discussed. And basics of mental health, like for example, stress, learning, memory. So all these things are also covered. At least one question on alternate basis, so that is also featured. Then obsessive compulsive disorders, which are kind of anxiety disorders, even an alternate basis. So again, OCD is covered either in terms of asking of clinical features or in terms of treatment. Okay. And dissociative disorders are the ones again with a clinical scenario, mainly clinical scenario is given. So to differentiate from other like mood disorders or anxiety disorders, dissociative disorders are also have been featured in the last few year questions. So straight away, without wasting much time, we'll go I'll be trying to cover all these topics and related to the questions. So also will be flashed here so that we'll discuss, and additional points will be parallelly discussed. Right. So this is one simple question. We'll begin with the easier ones now. So under psychopharmacology, so we have antidepressants, antipsychotics, mood stabilizers, benzodiazepines, anti-anxiety medications, medications for ADHD. So these are the major ones that needs some kind of a coverage. Okay. So coming to this question, all of the following features are less commonly associated with SSRIs, except. So here, you'll have to observe here that there are double negative here. One is less commonly, then again, except. Okay. So it means to say that the following features are associated with SSRIs. That's what it amounts to. So if you see the any answers, because this seems to be the simpler one. Anyway, not yet seen any chat box messages so far. It's okay. So here, one needs to know that SSRIs, that is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, have gastric irritation. Okay. You have weight gain. You have sexual dysfunction. Yeah, somebody answered Michael Jackson. Yeah, sexual dysfunction. Okay. So these are the ones which are seen with SSRIs. So all the other three, constipation, dryness of mouth, and blurring of vision. These are particularly seen with tricyclic antidepressants, okay, because of anticholinergic side effects. So these features are seen more often with tricyclic antidepressants. While sexual dysfunction, it is the answer here. Okay, so just a few points here. In terms of tricyclic antidepressants, okay, so one needs to remember that the following are the side effects, that is dry mouth, constipation, you have blurring of vision, urinary retention, hypotension. Okay, so that's one of the reason why tricyclic antidepressants are not prescribed in people with glaucoma or elderly males, particularly because of existence of benign prostatic hypertrophy, which can be worsened with this urinary retention. And also because of postural hypotension, so elderly people, they are more prone to falls. Okay, so that's one of the reason why tricyclic antidepressants are not preferred in elderly. When it comes to SSRIs, as it is already discussed, so the main things are gastric irritation, weight gain, sexual dysfunction, more so in males. And there is one other phenomenon observed is paradoxical anxiety. Okay, so in the initial period, at least 1 or 2 weeks, instead of improvement in the anxiety symptoms, patients can have worsening of anxiety symptoms, wherein it needs a reassurance from the consultant psychiatrist that yeah, it will come down. Okay, so then one other group is MAO inhibitors. Okay, so can anyone say about the side effect of MAO inhibitors? Moclobemide, selegiline are the drugs. Significant side effect of MAO inhibitors. Anyway, so MAO inhibitors are known to cause what is called as cheese reaction. So this is a kind of a hypertensive crisis which happens because of consumption of dairy products like cheese, milk related products, because they are rich in tyramine, which is a precursor for dopamine. So when dairy products are consumed, those who are on MAO inhibitors, so this particular enzyme, that is monoamine oxidase inhibitor, so this particular inhibition causes accumulation of tyramine, which gives way for more synthesis of dopamine and hypertensive crisis. So because of this, MAO inhibitors are not routinely used. Okay, and only preferred when drug-resistant depression, in case of drug-resistant depression. Okay, so these are all the certain side effects of, one other thing that you'll have to remember is, when it comes to atypical antidepressants, okay, so there are few side effects that one needs to know here. Okay, so bupropion is one. Venlafaxin, you have mirtazapine, trazodone. Okay, so it's worthwhile to remember here that under this atypical antidepressants, bupropion, though it is also used in nicotine dependence, that is for tobacco cessation. So it causes seizures. Okay, apart from sedation, it also causes seizures. Venlafaxine, when it comes to this group of medications, so it causes hypertension. And mirtazapine, it causes sedation and also prolongation of QTC. And when it comes to trazodone, though rarer, it causes priapism. Okay, one of the question in INICET was about priapism causing antidepressant. Okay, trazodone is the implicated agent. Okay, right. So, one other question. This is with regard to mood stabilizer here. Okay, a nurse needs to instruct a patient on timing for serum lithium test. Which of the following is the correct instruction? Any answers? Yeah, maybe because of the delay, the previous questions answers are seen in the chat box. Yeah, right. Muskan Jindal, like anticholinergic, like side effects. Yes. For this question, any answers? Yeah, Manu H. So, respond correctly. That can be done after 5 days of regular medications. See, here, the confusing thing is, the first option can be done anytime after 24 hours of medication, can be done after 3 weeks, here 5 days, and this is a kind of a none of the above here. So one needs to know that lithium has to achieve a steady state concentration to evaluate the serum lithium level, right? So the initial loading dose, whatever it's given, for example, 300 mg or 600 mg, so it takes about 5 days, because the half-life of lithium is about 1.2 days. Okay, so it takes about 4 T-halves to achieve a steady state level. Okay, so it is in this context that usually a serum lithium level is ordered on a 5th day of any change in the medication or starting of the medication. So there is one other instruction that we give the patient on medication, regular medication, has to consume the night dosage of medication lithium and has to come at least fasting about 12 hours and not having had the morning dosage. He has to get his blood sample drawn and then he can have the medication. So that sample which depicts a lithium level is taken as the steady state level. Okay. So here in this regard, one needs to know about therapeutic level and prophylactic level of serum lithium. Any answers? Because this is the one standard question, which is just a kind of a factual remembrance, right? So therapeutic level of serum lithium, because it has got a narrow therapeutic index. That's what many of the pharmacology books mentions about particular reference to lithium. So therapeutic level, any answers? So it's about 0.8 to 1.2 milliequivalents per liter, okay? While prophylactic level is 0.6 to 1.0, okay? One might wonder, because undergraduate period wherein they might wonder as to what is the difference between this therapeutic level and prophylactic level. So when the patient presents with mania, so there needs to be kind of a therapeutic improvement that has to happen, right? So it requires bit higher serum lithium level to achieve. Yeah, again, Manu has messaged correctly. Just a minor there. 0.8 to 1.2 milliequivalents per liter. Okay. So, that is the therapeutic level wherein the initial symptom resolution occurs with 0.8 to 1.2 milliequivalents. Okay. While prophylactic level, when the patient has had resolution from the symptoms and the patient has to be maintained so that he or she doesn't have the recurrence of the mood episodes. So that is when this prophylactic level are required. It is about 0.6 to 1.0 milliequivalents per liter. Okay. So the narrow therapeutic index is one concept wherein below which the lithium doesn't act, I mean, it's not effective at all, or above which it becomes toxic. Okay, that's what the narrow therapeutic index mean. Okay, and one other thing that we have to remember here is that while giving instruction to the patients and the family members with particular regard to lithium, so they have to be instructed to have adequate hydration, particularly when it is summer. So people tend to have kind of a dehydration. So they need to be instructed to have adequate hydration. Other than this, if at all, if they have any concurrent illness which causes vomiting, diarrhea, or any such dehydrating illnesses with fever, so they have to stop temporarily this lithium medications. And when they recover from their dehydrating illness, they can resume this medication. Okay. Even while on regular dosage, because of dehydration, the serum lithium level might go up. Okay. So it is the serum lithium level that matters more than the dosage that is being taken. Okay. Hope it is understood. Right. There's one more related question here in that regard. A bipolar disorder patient has been on lithium. She must look out for which of the following symptoms if there is a concern of lithium toxicity. Any answers? A patient on lithium. So what they need to monitor in terms of lithium toxicity? What are the features? Options are fever, malaise and sore throat, skin rashes, unsteadiness, palpitation and breathlessness. So lithium toxicity occurs when it goes beyond 1.5. Okay. So here in this regard, the answer is unsteadiness, jerky movements or slurring of speech. Okay. Ataxia, tremors. Remember, tremors occurs at therapeutic level itself. So that shouldn't be considered as a kind of a toxicity. But coarse tremors, yeah, Manu has replied rightly. Unsteadiness, jerk and slurring of speech. Thank you. So these are the symptoms that are to be looked into. Ataxia. Okay. And while fever, malaise and sore throat, any guesses on which particular medication we keep monitoring, particularly an antipsychotic, which indicates kind of it's a kind of a red flag. Any guesses on that? So it's clozapine. So clozapine causes agranulocytosis, because of which, that is the better word would be neutropenia. Okay. So febrile neutropenia. So people have fever, malaise and sore throat, which can become really fatal if not addressed. Okay. So that's the danger associated with clozapine, though rarely seen. Okay. Right. Skin rashes with particular reference to mood stabilizers, it is seen with carbamazepine, oxcarbazepine. Okay. So one needs to know that, okay, other mood stabilizers can have side effects. So when it comes to lithium, we have seen that at therapeutic level itself, tremors can happen, weight gain, sedation. Okay. So toxicity will be like ataxia, coarse tremors, oliguria or anuria. Even person can go into coma, convulsions. Okay. When it comes to other mood stabilizer, that is valproate. So any guesses on what are the commoner side effects associated with valproate? Commoner side effects of valproate. Primarily an anticonvulsant. So, commoner ones are gastritis, sedation, weight gain. Okay. So, other than this, valproate can cause alopecia, PCOD like features. Okay. Then you have thrombocytopenia. Yeah, Manu, it's again messaged about weight gain. Yeah, that is the, it is notorious to cause weight gain. Okay. And rarely again, pancreatitis. Okay. Other than this, it's also got teratogenic side effects. Again, lithium also got teratogenic side effect, that is Epstein's anomaly. Though it is rare. Here in case of valproate, the teratogenic side effects are neural tube defects and also cardiac defects. Okay. So when it comes to carbamazepine, so other mood stabilizer, though again here it is primarily an anticonvulsant. So here already we have seen skin rashes, weight gain, and in elderly, they can have hyponatremia. Okay. So, these are all the commoner side effects and also rarer side effects associated with mood stabilizers. Okay. Yeah, one other question with regard to lithium again, because lithium seems to be a kind of a favorite with examiners or paper setters. So, a female patient with bipolar disorder is on lithium about 750 mg per day. She is pregnant and is in her third trimester. And she has come for a follow-up. She has not had any mood episodes since about 1 year and is maintaining well. What would be your next treatment strategy? So, any answers for this? Should we increase the dose of the lithium, decrease the dose of the lithium, or stop lithium and send her home, or change to sodium valproate? So, pregnant patient maintaining well on lithium has come in third trimester. So, these are the keywords that one has to note here. So, Stardust, they say that increase the dose. And one other option, D, that is change to sodium valproate. So, that means to say that there is kind of a discrepancy. Okay. So, here one needs to remember here that lithium is a kind of a most efficacious mood stabilizer out of the options. Okay. And when it comes to pregnancy, okay, so there are certain physiological changes that needs to be noted here. So, initially in pregnant women, yeah, Dr. Arpit says it's option C, stop lithium and send her home. Okay. So, anyway, so the correct answer seems to be decrease the dose of the lithium. So why, I'll try to explain to you. Okay. So out of the option, this is the best option, because GFR, it tends to increase in the early trimesters. Okay. So because of this reason, there seems to be kind of a dilution. That is, the serum lithium level decreases. Okay. That's when consultant psychiatrists tend to increase the dose of the lithium in the initial period, that is first and second trimester. They tend to increase the dose of the lithium to achieve the prophylactic or therapeutic level. Here in this case, it's a prophylactic level. Okay. But when it comes to third trimester, so that's when GFR, glomerular filtration rate, tends to be kind of a normalizing. Okay. So when that happens, the lithium level tends to seem to be increasing. Increasing in the sense as compared to the first and second trimester. Okay. So those of them who are, where the consultant psychiatrist have increased the dosage of the lithium to meet the desirable lithium level, in them, it tends to be like reaching toxic level. Okay. So this is the basis behind why if a woman presents in third trimester, so rather we think of decreasing the dose of the lithium. If at all, if they are maintaining well and the serum lithium level on measuring seems to be within the normal range, because there is an expected increase in the lithium level post third trimester. Okay. So here, if at all, if the question was such that if the patient has presented in first trimester and on measuring the lithium levels, it is below normal or even normal range, this answer would have been right. Okay. And remember, I should have started with a disclaimer saying INICET questions are recall based. So there seems to be some kind of errors creeping in because of the recall bias. Okay. So in that regard, it's not sure whether exactly the question was the same. Okay. So if at all, if it were to be a early trimester, increase the dose of the lithium. If it is third trimester, better option would be decrease the dose of the lithium or continue on the same dosage. Okay. But if only if the lithium levels are a toxic level or features are there, then only stop lithium and send her home, because she has been maintaining well. And if at all, if the fetus is also, baby is also maintaining well, then there is no point in stopping the lithium. And remember, changing to sodium valproate when patient has had an adequate improvement with the lithium is doesn't seem to be rational. Okay. So hope it is understood the rationale behind why decrease the dose of the lithium is the answer here. Okay. Right. So there are certain things that you'll have to remember with regard to lithium, that so far we have discussed about side effects. So what happens if the level crosses more than 1.5 milliequivalents or at times 2.0 milliequivalents? So wherein, that is the time when we'll have to stop the drug. And patients might also need hemodialysis, because remember, lithium is excreted unchanged in urine through kidneys. Okay. So whatever the damage that occurs is to the kidneys. Okay. On lithium toxicity causes, it can cause acute tubular damage and even acute renal failure if not treated. Okay. So this has to be kept in mind. Other than this, lithium can also cause hypothyroidism. Okay. Diabetes, insipidus like condition. Okay. Because it seems to be a favorite topic. So all the things concerned with lithium has to be learnt. Okay, in that regard, these are all the other side effects possible with lithium. Okay, right. Again, with regard to mood stabilizer here, a female patient with a previous history of mania 1 year back now presented with an episode of hypomania. Now she is pregnant. Which of the following drug to be avoided for being highly teratogenic to the fetus? Something we discussed just a few minutes back, that yeah, teratogenicity of mood stabilizers. Any answers for this? You can see that how the questions related to one another have been asked in the past few years. Any answers to this? Mohit Singla says A. Yeah, it's a right answer. Thank you. Valproate. So though it seems like all the lithium, olanzapine and oxcarbazepine also have some kind of a teratogenicity, but it is the sodium valproate which has highly teratogenicity, because it is believed that it's not only about neural tube defects, but also about other anomalies that is possible with sodium valproate. And lithium, when it comes to Epstein's anomaly, again, the current literature says that the causal association is still not established, okay? And it's also less than 1%, while the risk here in this is around 2%, okay? Right, in terms of mood stabilizers, the clinical practice is such that olanzapine or quetiapine are used as mood stabilizers, particularly in pregnancy. If any future questions are being asked about the potential mood stabilizers apart from lithium and anticonvulsants, so one needs to remember that olanzapine and quetiapine, they are with the having a substantial evidence to be used as mood stabilizers, particularly safety when it comes to safety in pregnancy. Okay. At times, patients have been shifted from lithium or valproate to olanzapine or quetiapine. Okay. When there are side effects are, yeah, of course, there is one other, lamotrigine is also can be used. Right, Mohit Singla says, yeah, lamotrigine. Yeah, definitely lamotrigine and olanzapine and quetiapine can be used. Right. Sorry for that here. I'll read it out for you. An elderly patient of bipolar disorder was put on mood stabilizer a week back. He had confusion and hyperammonemia. Which of the mood stabilizer is likely to cause this? We are trying to run through the mood stabilizers initially in the psychopharmacology. So under this, again, a bipolar disorder patient, a week back, a mood stabilizer was started. He had confusion and hyperammonemia. I mean, here the keywords are elderly patient, hyperammonemia. Any answers? Which of the mood stabilizer can cause hyperammonemia, particularly when loading doses are given? Anyway, the clue here is that it's again the same option that was told in the previous question. Here it is, sodium valproate. Okay, sodium valproate is one agent which can cause hyperammonemia. Though many of the chat box responses seems to be C, carbamazepine. Okay, so we discussed that, yeah, carbamazepine does cause a side effect, that is hyponatremia in elderly patients. Yeah, that's what is confusion here. So because we have had patients wherein elderly patients particularly were put on mood stabilizers. So they have had acute confusional state, that is kind of a delirium like state. So on exploring, these are the points that needs to be kept in mind. If the patient is on sodium valproate, so more likely is that hyperammonemia. If the patient is on carbamazepine, and particularly patients present with kind of a episodic confusional states, that is due to hyponatremia. Okay, so we have had many cases wherein elderly patients with delirium on mood stabilizers, so on evaluating the ammonium, serum ammonium levels, they have had significant increase in. On stopping the drug and restarting it gradually, so as worked well for them. Okay, that is a strategy we adopt when it comes to hyperammonemia phenomenon seen in patients. So either stop the drug and change over to the other drugs, or start slowly and build up gradually. Okay, so that's the strategy we adopt when it comes to elderly patients. Okay, so and remember, topiramate, one other drug, mood stabilizer, and then we have lamotrigine. In terms of efficacy, so they have got moderate efficacy, but not in comparison to lithium and valproate. And some of the side effects that you need to remember with regard to topiramate is renal calculi, and many of the patients would have had weight loss instead of weight gain that is seen with many of the mood stabilizers. Okay, and when it comes to lamotrigine, skin rashes, and at times, rarely, though rarely, Stevens-Johnson syndrome also. Severe form of allergic reaction. Okay, but rarely. Okay, right. So, one other question which is unrelated to a mood stabilizer, that is, an anesthetist gives succinylcholine and thiopentone to a patient receiving ECT for a severe depression. The reason for using these two drugs is... Any answers? Usually ECT. ECT is electroconvulsive therapy, which is indicated in a case of severe depression wherein suicidality is more. So before administering ECT, anesthetist will give succinylcholine and thiopentone to the patient. The rationale behind using these two medications is it to prevent seizures? Yeah. In the chat box, Stardust, they have responded saying anesthesia and muscle relaxation. Yeah, that's the right answer. Even Mohit Singla says the similar answer. Right. It is anesthesia and muscle relaxation. Remember, the other options can be ruled out in the sense that, yeah, preventing seizures is not the one that is intended here, because the purpose of giving ECT is to cause seizures, right? So, preventing seizures is not the answer, right? And mood elevation, it doesn't happen so soon, right? And the rationale behind giving succinylcholine is not that. And reduce the memory problems, it is not... concerned with the medications that the memory problems happen in the administration of ECT. Remember, it is reduced by giving a bifrontal ECT or unilateral ECT to reduce the memory disturbances that is seen with ECTs. Okay, so it comes down to anesthesia and muscle relaxation. Remember, as per the Mental Health Care Act 2017, so only modified ECTs are to be practiced, in the sense that anesthesia and muscle relaxation has to be there. Okay, so in that regard, Thiopentone is the general anesthetic used, and succinylcholine is the muscle relaxant used here. Okay. Thank you for answering. Yeah. Just one more question related to this. What if a patient has bronchial asthma and he or she has to be administered ECT? Okay. So is it the same succinylcholine and thiopentone that is used for administering ECT? Because during our postgraduate days, these were the circumstances encountered. The patient will be having bronchial asthma along with, and because of the busy schedule, so we would have overlooked this aspect and would have told the anesthetist even that, they can be given thiopentone or muscle relaxant, succinylcholine. So remember, here the point that I'm trying to bring in is bronchial asthma gets precipitated. There occurs bronchospasm with thiopentone and succinylcholine. Okay. So hence, the options are replace that with propofol, then vecuronium. Okay. These are the alternate anesthesia and muscle relaxant used in cases with bronchial asthma. Okay. And routinely, they will also have either glycopyrrolate or atropine as a pre-procedure. Yes, Manu H. has responded correctly that propofol can be used in patients with bronchial asthma. Right. So, glycopyrrolate and atropine are to be used to reduce the secretion. Okay. Right. Here, it is concerned with antidepressant now. A patient was treated with tricyclic antidepressant for a major depressive episode in hospital for 4 weeks. Which of the following is a main concern while considering his discharge? So, patient on tricyclic antidepressant has been in hospital for 4 weeks. So, now is considering for discharge. So, what is the main concern? Is it suicidal risk, ECG monitoring for arrhythmias, drug monitoring, sedation being the side effect? Any answers? Mohit Singla says it's ECG monitoring for arrhythmias. But having stayed in hospital for 4 weeks while on tricyclic antidepressants, so is it the thing needed at the time of the discharge? Yes, Stardust has responded correctly that it's a suicidal risk. That is the most important one here. Yeah, that's what he mentions about paradoxical suicide. I'll come to that part. Anyway, the right answer is suicidal risk, because ECG monitoring, as I've told you, for arrhythmias, if it happens, it would have happened much earlier during the stay. So they would have, there is no need to monitor at the time of the discharge. And drug monitoring is not routinely done, at least in India, when it comes to tricyclic antidepressants. And sedation being the side effects would have been obvious in the 4 weeks of stay. So here, the suicidal risk is the main, most of them seems to be getting the right answer here, that is suicidal risk. Because it is seen that depressed patients on being treated, so they tend to have a kind of a suicidal behavior, which is a kind of a paradoxical to what is expected out of them. Okay, because they'll be improving over on the depressive symptoms and the suicidal risk. But there is a suicidal risk. It is because in a moderate to severe depression, the patient will be so psychomotor activity is so slow, and even the energy levels are so less that the person though contemplating suicide. Yeah, ideally, Starter said, do we need to therapeutic monitoring of tricyclic antidepressants? But routinely, it is not done here. Okay. So, on improvement, this energy levels and also psychomotor activity tends to improve. And also, they tend to have a kind of a better orientation and insight, wherein the guilt part, which makes them to act upon, and the energy levels which has improved will make them commit that. So that's when you see kind of a paradoxically suicidal behavior, that to tricyclic antidepressants or even SSRIs for that matter, they do have suicidal behavior seen, which is not directly attributable to medications. Okay. So, one other related question here. A 30-year-old lady with depression was on amitriptyline, again a tricyclic antidepressant, and has been brought in altered consciousness and suspected overdosage of medication. Which one of the following features is not suggestive of amitriptyline overdosage? Any answers for this? The options are hypothermia, arrhythmia, dilated pupils, and tachycardia. Yeah, Muskan Jindal says its option is A, hypothermia. Any others wants to try? Yeah, it's the right answer. Hypothermia. The tricyclic antidepressants as such have side effects already we have discussed. That is, it causes arrhythmias, okay, because of quinidine like action, dilated pupils, and tachycardia. So at times when tricyclic antidepressants are given as an overdosage or combined with SSRIs or MAO inhibitors, when concurrently two antidepressants are used, there is one syndrome which is observed, that is serotonin syndrome, okay, which is characterized by hyperthermia. Okay, so it is at times hyperthermia rather than hypothermia that is seen with overdosage of amitriptyline, that is tricyclic antidepressants. Okay, so hence hypothermia is the right answer here. Coming to the one other antipsychotic medication this time, related question. An young adult earlier diagnosed as schizophrenia was taking some antipsychotic medication. He presented to casualty with sudden twisting of neck muscles, tremulousness of hands, stiffening of fingers, protrusion of tongue. He is frightened and restless. You are in the casualty. How will you manage the patient? Any answers to this? We have seen more often with young adults, okay, who are prescribed antipsychotic medications, okay. Yeah, people seem to be getting the right answer here, that is give IM promethazine. Yeah, what is the phenomenon that is seen here? Yeah, right answer. All of you have got it right. Purnami, Stardust, Manu, Monisha, right? All of you have got the right answer, that is promethazine. One of the responses, akathisia. No, that's not classical of akathisia, right? Akathisia is something to do with the inner or outward restlessness. Outward restlessness getting manifested as pacing around, walking. Options, oculogyric crisis, again same akathisia is being repeated. What the phenomenon seen here is acute dystonia. Okay, so we're in oculoglossary crisis. There is a, yeah, Monisha says it's a EPS. EPS is a broader group of, broader concept. Okay, under which acute dystonia is a specific phenomenon that is can be correlated with current presentation. Okay, so here, remember, as the name says, it is a dystonia, altered tone of the muscle. More often, on giving, that's what. Right answer is acute dystonia. Right. So, acute dystonia is, it's a sustained painful contraction of group of muscles, more so the limb girdles more often, but it can also involve neck muscles and also at times laryngeal muscles, wherein it can be really dangerous because people can go into a kind of a choking. Okay. So, giving haloperidol is not the right answer because already an offending agent is an antipsychotic. Giving again olanzapine, again the similar results are seen. So promethazine, which is an which has an anticholinergic effect, will relieve the symptoms of dystonia. Okay. And the last one, reassure the attendants that the patient is nothing serious, is not the right answer because there is this sustained contraction to the even protrusion of the tongue, which is kind of involuntary. Okay. Even the person desiring to put it in will not be able to put it in. Okay. So remember here in this regard, the extrapyramidal symptoms one needs to know about with relation to antipsychotics. Yeah. The question Phenergan. Yeah. Phenergan is a trade name while promethazine is a generic name of the drug. KK. So, yes, put a query that Phenergan or promethazine are one and the same. So, they are the same. One is trade name, the generic name. Okay. Extrapyramidal effects. So, that are seen are, one is Parkinsonism. That is tremors, rigidity, and bradykinesia. Okay, these are routinely seen. Okay, since it mimics the triad of Parkinson's disease, it is referred to as Parkinsonism, that is drug induced Parkinsonism. Okay, it is characterized by resting tremors, rigidity, and bradykinesia. Okay, while the other is acute dystonia, as we saw in this case, which is a sustained force, painful contraction of group of muscles. Okay. Then other one is akathisia. Okay. So when it involves dystonia, involves the ocular muscles. So it is referred to as oculoglossary crisis, which is manifested as upward movement of the eye, involuntary movement, okay, and patient presents to casualty with trying to compensate it for while looking up. Okay, so akathisia is restlessness, okay, either inner or outwardly manifested. Muskan Jindal is asking a question that promethazine is used due to the anticholinergic effect. It is believed that the hypothesis is that it is because of the imbalance between the dopamine and the acetylcholine that happens in the basal ganglia that results in extrapyramidal side effects. And by giving anticholinergics, even the cholinergic activity is brought under control so that there is a balance between dopaminergic and cholinergic activity. That's how the symptom resolution occurs. That's the hypothesis. Okay. So, that's the reason why the anticholinergic effect of promethazine is made use of in treatment of the side effects. Okay. So, other one is tardive dyskinesia, which is otherwise called as rabbit syndrome. People would have heard of the perioral tremors and the orofacial dyskinetic movements that is seen with long-term administration of antipsychotics, particularly first generation, but it's also can be seen with second generation antipsychotics as well. But one thing is clozapine is not found to be associated with this tardive dyskinesia, and that is the one antipsychotic that is used in patients with tardive dyskinesia. Okay, right. Hope things are a bit clear. Now coming to the substance use disorders. So far we have covered psychopharmacology. Yeah, the one other thing we missed out was neuroleptic malignant syndrome, which is a severe form of KK. So NMS. So it is a severe form of extrapyramidal side effects characterized by hyperthermia, rigidity, hypertension. Okay, so wherein muscle breakdown can lead on to again acute renal failure, metabolic exhaustion. So it's a kind of a medical emergency. Okay, even medications like dantrolene are used to bring down the temperature. Okay, thank you for that. Patient was a known alcoholic, comes to the emergency disoriented with complaints that he is seeing snakes and insects crawling on his skin. Which of the following treatment should be given to this patient? Known alcoholic, complaining that seeing snakes, so that means to say that hallucinations, okay, with the disorientation. Yeah, Manu says it's lorazepam and thiamine. Any other answers? Yeah, even the KK, he also seems to be saying lorazepam and thiamine. Yeah, that's a right answer. Seems to be a simple one. But remember, it is delirium here. So this is not referred to as a Magnan bugs, which is classically seen with cocaine intoxication. Okay, here the person was chronic alcoholic. He has presented with withdrawal symptoms. Okay, and in particular, the severe form of withdrawal state is delirium, delirium tremens. Okay, in which patients can have hallucinations, delusions, disorientation. Okay, in that regard, haloperidol though seems to be kind of a bringing down the agitation, but definitive treatment is lorazepam. Okay, because it is the delirium that we need to treat here rather than the psychotic symptoms through haloperidol. Okay, if one treats the delirium, the hallucinations and delusions will automatically resolve. So that's the reason why this option is better out of the lot. Okay, and disulfiram, remember, though many undergraduates make a mistake that when it comes to alcohol, disulfiram can be straight away given. Okay, remember, disulfiram is not given in acute intoxication or during the withdrawal state, wherein still alcohol is still in the blood. Okay, because it immediately starts disulfiram ethanol reaction causing worsening of the condition. Okay, disulfiram is an aversive agent which is given after treatment of the withdrawal symptoms. Okay, yeah, Sukruti Soni and Mohit Singla, they have got it right. While Purnami, haloperidol, I just now explained that, antipsychotic effect is not the one we are intending here. It's a treatment of, so there's a question, what is the drug of choice for alcoholic withdrawal seizures and when do we use haloperidol in alcohol withdrawal? The drug of choice for alcohol withdrawal seizures are benzodiazepines. Okay, there is a controversy or arguments in terms of whether the withdrawal seizures are to be treated with anticonvulsants. Okay, but if it is established that it's clearly the withdrawal seizures, okay, then it is benzodiazepines which are the drug of choice, okay, not phenytoin, phenobarbital or any other anticonvulsants, okay. So this is adequate even after correctly administering the drug and tapering and stopping the benzodiazepines. There won't be any recurrences of seizures that is seen. Only in case of those who have vulnerability or independent seizures. So in them, yeah, there can be recurrences. And when do we use haloperidol? Okay. So routinely, because of the options, we thought that this is a better option. Otherwise, lorazepam, haloperidol and thiamine, all three are considered in the treatment of alcohol withdrawal, because at times this agitation and the psychotic symptoms have resolved with the administration of haloperidol as well. Okay, at times lorazepam on reaching the maximum limit, people would not have have the resolution from the withdrawal symptoms, agitation and restlessness, during which again haloperidol is indicated. In clinical practice, after about 16 mg of lorazepam in a day, 24 hours period, so usually haloperidol is considered over and above lorazepam. Okay, hope I've answered your query, Stardust. Thank you for the doubt. Okay, so it is in this regard that I just want to highlight here the point that the medications that are used in connection to alcohol dependence, that is disulfiram, being an aversive agent, while other drugs like naltrexone, valproate, ondansetrone, baclofen and even SSRIs, they are anti-craving agents. Yeah, of course, I missed out on acamprosate here. Thank you, Muskan Jindal. Okay. So these are all the anti-craving agents, while disulfiram is an aversive agent. Okay. The mechanism is a bit different in the sense that disulfiram, with the patient education and consent from the patient, the disulfiram is ideally started from 250 mg. Okay. Yes, baclofen has, yeah, anti-craving. Manu has said, okay. Right. So it is not started during the withdrawal state. Okay. While in comparison, some of the drugs like valproate, ondansetron, baclofen, and even SSRIs or acamprosate can be started in withdrawal state itself. Okay, so that's a difference. Okay, and aversive agent, the patients have to be ideally, so patient have to be ideally given consent, and also they are supposed to be made experiencing those symptoms. Earlier there was a concept like aversion treatment, wherein while on medication with disulfiram, okay, so they were given small amounts of alcohol and made to experience those disulfiram ethanol reaction, okay, wherein in a hospital setup, and the but nowadays it is not done. So that is the basis wherein the patient experiences that side effects and becomes aversive to it, okay. And coming to the query of Muskan Jindal, ondansetron, how it can act as an anti-craving drug. So though it acts on 5-HT receptor, the definitive reason is not known, just like again baclofen, wherein it seems like a membrane stabilizing action is a basis for the anti-craving effects that are seen, okay, with ondansetron or baclofen. Right? Going to the next question, which of the following statements is false about disulfiram? Any answers? Which of the statement is false about disulfiram? accumulates acetaldehyde, initiated at 250 mg, not an anti-craving agent, inhibits alcohol dehydrogenase. Because students make a mistake here in this case. Yeah. KK says it's option A, while Sukruti says C. The right answer is this. Even Mohit Singla has got it correct. While Monisha has again said initiated at 250 mg. Wrong. Out of the option, this is right because disulfiram inhibits aldehyde dehydrogenase. Okay, that is the reason why acetaldehyde accumulates. Okay, if you can just remember, alcohol gets metabolized to aldehyde and then aldehyde to organic acids like acetic acid. Right, so here alcohol dehydrogenase acts. Okay, while here it is aldehyde dehydrogenase. So at times it's misleading here. People won't read this alcohol dehydrogenase, they read it as aldehyde dehydrogenase and not mark that. Okay, and remember, accumulates acetaldehyde is right, initiated at 250 mg and even go up to 500 mg per day. And it's not an anti-craving agent, it's a aversive agent. Okay, so what is the alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor that you know of? Aldehyde dehydrogenase is disulfiram. Alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor? Any answers? Which is actually used in methanol poisoning, wherein at least in alcohol, this step is when it is inhibited, aldehyde accumulates. But when it comes to methanol, even the first step, if it goes through, it will be again detrimental. So that's the reason alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor, that is fomepizole. Yeah, right answer. Fomepizole is the drug which inhibits alcohol dehydrogenase, that is made use of. Okay. Yeah, all of you have got it right. Fomepizole. So, moving further, a chronic smoker wanting to quit is treated with which of the following oral medications? Yeah, thank you. Thank you all of you for getting the right answers. Chronic smoker wanting to quit is treated with which of the following oral medications? Varenicline, muscarin, sevimelin, atropine. Yeah. Mohit Singla, KK, they've got it right. It is the varenicline. Okay. So here, one needs to remember that varenicline is a partial agonist at nicotinic receptor, while these two are agonists at muscarinic receptors, and this is anticholinergic. Okay, so all of you have got it right, that is varenicline. So this varenicline has been quite frequently asked, so it's better to know that. Okay, that the action is on nicotinic receptor. Okay, though after releasing into market, it was seen that the suicidal behavior was more, but off late again it has been reintroduced and still under the trade name, that is Champix. So varenicline is used and quite efficacious. Okay, so one other thing with relation to tobacco dependence, that is nicotine dependence, there is something called as nicotine replacement therapy. That is NRT. So wherein the forms that are used are gums, lozenges, patches, sprays, e-cigarettes. Okay. So yeah, nicotine replacement therapy. So more often gums and lozenges are used, wherein the individuals are suggested, because they are available in 2mg or 4mg. Okay, nowadays you find it in advertisements as well, wherein the patient desirous of quitting tobacco can go and purchase over the counter, right? Nicotex and Nicolan, so some of the brands there. So yeah, most commonly used is nicotine replacement therapy, and other forms are medications, that is bupropion, varenicline, and even other SSRIs are also used if there are concurrent depressive symptoms are also there. Okay, when it comes to usage of gums and lozenges, so practical suggestions given to people are that based on the amount of cigarettes they smoke, so it is arrived at that the dosage that they can start with. Again, remember, it's a replacement therapy wherein again it has to be tapered and stopped. Okay, unlike alcohol withdrawal state, which lasts for about usually uncomplicated 7 to 10 days, the withdrawal symptoms can last for about 1 month or even goes beyond. So that's one of the reason why the replacement therapy in terms of nicotine replacement therapy, so it is bit more in duration. Okay, so every week 1 or 2 mg reduction or 4 mg reduction is advised, and the individual has to start chewing the gum, and then they'll have to keep it at one side, so that have to alternate with and keep chewing, and once they get some kind of a bitter taste fluid is there, so they can stop chewing, swallow that, and keep repeating for about 30 to 45 minutes, and then spit it out, gargle and wash the mouth, and it is to be used at the peak of the craving. Okay, so or they routinely, whenever they used to smoke cigarettes, so that is the time period we suggest them to take this gums. And remember, it is not in addition to the cigarettes. Okay, so this fact has to be stressed, that is, it is a replacement rather than in addition. Okay, otherwise the amount of nicotine going into somebody's blood will be more than actual. Okay, right. So next question is about general substance dependence. Which of the following is used in diagnosing substance dependence? At times questions like this, which are simpler, can also be asked, but one needs to be sure about at least the basics. So here in this case, answer is it strong desire to use the drug, priority to use drug than other activities, increased tolerance, continuous use of drugs in spite of harm, any answers? Which of the following is used in diagnosing? Mohit Singla says C, increased tolerance. Any other answers? Manu says D, continued use of drugs in spite of harm. Dr. Podmi also says it's D, continuous use of drugs in spite of harm. Actually, it is because of the mistake that the four options are also, right. Okay. So actually, there was one other. If all of the above option was there, so that is right. In this case, I do agree that it's a kind of a mistake here. So all four options are correct. Okay. So if you were to list out So craving is the first thing. Loss of control. Okay. You have withdrawal symptoms. You have something called a salience. You have use despite harm. Okay, and tolerance. So classically, these six criterion are considered while diagnosing any substance dependence for that matter, more often alcohol, opioids, and tobacco. So craving is the intense desire to consume the substance, and loss of control is about typically saying like how much they consume and how long they consume, they lose control over it, though they think of just having it a bit, so they end up having lot of, okay, losing the control. Withdrawal symptoms, upon stopping or reducing the dosage, people experience psychological and physical symptoms, which is referred to as withdrawal. While salience is the priority to use drug than any other pleasurable activity or social responsibilities. And when that becomes the revolving principle in their life, so that is referred to as salience. While the use despite harm is self-explaining, wherein in spite of the harm, like hematemesis or seizures, jaundice, person continues to use. And tolerance is increasing amounts needed to obtain a same amount of pleasurable effect. Okay, so remember all of the above. Okay, if there are options, because already I said because of the recall bias, so maybe the all the options are right here. Okay. So coming to the this question wherein it's about dementias. Okay, all of the following conditions are related with the same core pathology except Alzheimer's disease, Lewy body dementia, Parkinson's disease, multisystem atrophy. Any answers? In terms of pathological basis, so out of the options, three are connected. Muskan Jindal says it's D. Even Sukruti Soni says it's D. Is it because it's not often heard? Yeah, most of them seems to be saying a D. But the actual answer is Alzheimer's disease here. See, these three options are referred to as Parkinson's plus syndromes. Okay. While Alzheimer's disease is about beta amyloid and tau protein accumulation. Okay. So that is the one which differentiates it from the core pathology. Here, Alzheimer's disease has accumulation of beta amyloid and tau protein, while all these three are referred to as Parkinson plus syndromes, wherein alpha synuclein are the accumulation occurs. Okay. So when it comes to dementia, there are few points that one needs to remember. Okay. When teaching to the undergraduates, it is observed that people equate dementia with Alzheimer's disease. Equate in the sense, I mean, they think that it is the only dementia. But remember, dementias are it's a broader concept under which there are various dementias. For example, other dementias are vascular dementia, which is happening because of the atherosclerosis or diabetes, hypertension, various reasons if the blood circulation to the brain is interfered with. So, wherein vascular dementia occurs. Okay. Dementia associated with Parkinson's disease. you have Huntington's disease. You have AIDS, dementia complex. You have prion disease, frontotemporal dementia or Pick's disease. Okay, so these are all the various dementias. Okay, so Alzheimer's is the one disease which is most common and has an idiopathic etiology. Okay, so wherein memory disturbances are seen early. Okay, while in frontotemporal dementia, it's a behavioral symptoms like hallucinations, delusions, personality changes, which is seen early than the memory loss. Okay, wherein prion's disease and Huntington's disease, they have a rapidly deteriorating course. Okay, and there is one question that keeps repeating about reversible dementias. So people have to know that there are conditions under dementias which are reversible in the sense that they are treatable. Okay, so some of them are due to hypothyroidism, vitamin B12 deficiency, surgical causes like subdural hematoma or normal pressure hydrocephalus. Okay, these are the certain examples of reversible dementias. Okay, so on the approach to investigate patients with dementing illness should be focusing on initially to rule out the reversible causes, so that because rest of the other dementias are gradually progressive and deteriorating. Okay, so in that regard, not much can be done about it, but at least in terms of quality of life, there are certain treatment strategies. Okay, right. So coming to the next question, all of the following are types of subcortical dementias except. Any answers? This again seems to be a simpler question. As the name says, it is a subcortical involvement, because more often dementias are associated with the cortical. Mohit Singla and Muskan Jindal, they're saying it's a Wilson's disease. Sure? Any other answers? Huntington's, Parkinson's, Wilson have some commonality, that is subcortical involvement. Okay, more often the basal ganglia structures, they involve. That's one of the reason why you see along with the dementia features, yeah, Stardust and Mohit Singla, they say Pick's disease or otherwise called as frontotemporal dementia. So as you, the name says, if you can just remember that Pick's disease is one other word, terminology that is used to indicate frontotemporal dementia. Okay, here the frontal and temporal cortex are the ones which are earlier seen affected. Okay, so that's the reason why it is cortical dementia. Even Alzheimer's is, it's a cortical dementia. Okay, well, Huntington's, Parkinson, so because of the involvement of subcortical structures like basal ganglia, so movement disorders are also concurrently seen with these three conditions. Okay, right. So which of the following features differentiate delirium from dementia in Alzheimer's disease? This is one other context that they keep asking, differentiation from delirium versus dementia. Since it's often repeated, most of the students have learnt it factually, that yeah, this keyword that they look for is yeah, Dr. Abhirami says that it's a basal ganglia involvement that differentiates from cortical dementia. Thank you. Yeah. So, Manu says it's option A. Starter says it's B. Okay. So, remember I just said this loss of consciousness is the word that they look for. Yeah, Muskan Jindal says, did we list Wilson's in the dementia list? So, yeah. While listing it out in the previous slide, so I missed out on Wilson's disease. Yeah, Wilson's can be listed under dementia list. Okay. So here the right answer is acute onset and loss of consciousness here. So remember, dementia is characterized with insidious onset and agitation can be there. Hallucinations and impaired memory. Yeah, can be there as part of a dementia rather than a delirium. Agitation and irritation again are indicative of dementia. While acute onset more often, okay, and loss of consciousness. It is the consciousness which is preserved in the dementia. That is seems to be the differentiating point. While other features like autonomic instability, okay, then you have acute onset, underlying cause like dyselectrolytemia or withdrawal state, okay, or acute intoxication, so all can be seen along with, okay. So those are the other additional features which differentiates from delirium versus dementia. Moving further, so a patient is experiencing low mood, decrease in interest and energy. He is not eating food for 1 week. His thought sample reveals, I have lost my head, I am dead. How can I eat? What is the delusion seen here? Patient has depressive symptoms. Over and above that, his thought sample says that, he is saying, I have lost my head. Dr. Abhirami says it's B. Or is it for the previous question? I'm not sure. Dr. Purnami says it's C. Yeah, most of you seems to be getting the right answer here. Nihilistic delusion, which is seen as a part of Cotard syndrome. Okay, as a part. Okay. So while erotomanic delusion is a person having delusion that the person who is higher to them in terms of authority or designation, so they seem to be in love with them. So that is erotomanic delusion. While hypochondriacal delusion is, it's about preoccupation about some serious illness, okay, based on the symptoms that they have, okay. While bizarre delusion is something which is unplausible, for example, somebody from alien world, so putting some devices into brain and then trying to control, and they're trying to pick up the messages and also remove the body parts. So these kind of things are bizarre, which is not biologically plausible. So those are referred to as totally abnormal or odd. So they're referred to as bizarre delusion. Here in this case, it is the nihilistic, as if like the world is coming to end, my intestines are rotten. So these are the classical description that they give. Okay, here also it is seen similarly. I've lost my head and I am dead. So how can I eat? So the thing is nihilistic delusion. Right. Yeah, got it, Dr. Abhirami, though. It seems like it's for the previous question. Thank you. Right. So 40-year-old male patient comes to psychiatric OPD. Sorry, the spelling mistake there. With complaint of having a repetitive thoughts, but his hands are dirty, though they are not. He knows that these are his own thoughts only. This gives him discomfort and hence he has to watch them again and again. This disorder of thought is referred to as, in terms of either it is a disorder of stream, form, content, or possession. This is based on psychopathology. We discussed that this is one of the, again, IEL topic. Yeah, most of you seems to be answering it right already. So, it is the possession. So, when we describe thought as part of mental status examination, okay? So, we describe it under form, stream, content, and then possession. Okay? So, form is to do with whether the words said in juxtaposition makes a meaningful sentence. Okay, when the disorder is seen, we refer to as formal thought disorder. So either dissociation, derailing, or word salad. So these are the examples of lacking the form. While in terms of stream, people can have increased flow of thoughts, particularly seen in mania. Okay, or retarded stream seen in depression. Okay, in terms of content, the abnormalities can be like delusions or overvalued ideas. Okay, and other suicidal ideas. All this gets covered under content. Even the flight of ideas is nothing but increased stream of flight of ideas, which is seen in stream. Okay. So, when it comes to possession, the abnormalities that are seen are, one is thought alienation, and then you have obsessions and compulsions. Okay. We can describe it to your possession. Okay. So, thought alienation. Because here we saw that the person believes that there is thoughts only. Okay. That's a differentiating point to say that it is obsession. Okay. So, thought alienation, you see thought insertion, thought withdrawal, and thought broadcasting. Okay, as the name says, as if the thoughts are inserted forcefully against their will. So, that is referred to as thought insertion. If the experience is such that the person says, my thoughts are being withdrawn against my will, so that is thought withdrawal. If the thoughts are being known to others, even without being told, so he senses that, yeah, in the real time kind of experience, so that is referred to as thought broadcasting. Well, obsession, so it has some qualities, because certain questions when it is given, so if the description is such that it meets this quality, so that can be interpreted as obsessions. One is repetitive. That's the first important thing. Then intrusive. Then they are regarded as their own thoughts. That is also one requisite here. And causes distress. They are, at least some point of time, they are felt as silly or irrational. And more they try to control it, it increases. Okay. So, these are the qualities of obsessions. So, some of the common obsessions are contamination. You have blasphemous. You have pathological doubts. So, contamination is the most common, while pathological doubts are the next common. Okay. They can have sexual obsessions or aggressive obsessions, hoarding. Okay. These are the various obsessions. Okay. It's worthwhile to just brush through this because some of the questions related to psychopathology can be simpler ones. Okay. Right. So, which of the following characteristic is true about stress? Coming to basics in mental health. Nowadays, the current competency-based medical education has in its curriculum described that the initial topics are basics in mental health, wherein stress, learning, memory, these are the subtopics that are discussed. Okay. So, can somebody answer this? Which of the following characteristics is true about stress? Is it impending doom, constant worry about negative consequences, preoccupation with illness, and emotional, cognitive, physiological, and autonomic response? Stardust says it's B. Any other answers? Dr. Prerna says it's D. Monisha, Dr. Purnami says it's B. The answer, correct answer is, yeah, even Dr. Sukriti has got it right. An emotional, cognitive, physiological and autonomic response. Remember, though stress is a kind of a buzzword that is used nowadays, technically speaking, so stress is just a response, okay? It is based on whether that is helpful or not. It is, they are referred to as eustress or distress. Okay. Remember, stress by per se is just a response to any stimulus or a problem. Okay. So, it can be emotional, cognitive or physiological or autonomic. Okay. So, when it arouses a positive consequences and it helps the person to cope with the problems or the conflicts, okay, so it is referred to as eustress. When the person has detrimental effects or it's beyond his coping resources and the response that he mounts to a problem causes more a problem, then it becomes distress. Okay, there's a difference. Okay. It is this distress which is commonly referred to as stress. Okay, but psychologically or technically speaking, stress is just an emotional or cognitive or physiological or autonomic response to any stimulus. Okay, so impending doom is more to do with a panic attack. Constant worry about negative consequences is a part of GAD, generalized anxiety disorder. Preoccupation about illness is what we refer to as hypochondriacal ideas. Okay. Hope at least some of the things are clear here. Okay. When it comes to stress. Okay. Right. So, just a few more questions are there. That's it. Because it's been already more than 1.5 hour. A person often feels that his hands are contaminated and he is forced to wash his hands. Recently, he feels this repetitive distressing thought or repetitive hand washing has begun affecting his performance. Which of the following is best treatment option for this patient? Though the options are in abbreviations, but hope it is known to students. DBT is dialectical behavioral therapy. CBT is cognitive behavioral therapy. ERP is exposure and response prevention, and SD is systematic desensitization. Okay. Muskan Jindal says it's B, while Dr. Prerna says it's C. Even Dr. Monisha, yeah, now Muskan has changed to C again. Because, yeah, I do agree that there is a bit of confusion here that the scenario is simple, right? It's a OCD. Now, when it comes to treatment aspect, ideally, both medications and behavioral therapy combination is the best option. Now, coming to the current options here, dialectical behavioral therapy is a form of behavioral therapy which is given to borderline personality disorders. Okay. And CBT seems to be also right, but if given this options, so definitely would be ERP, because the patient has repetitive hand washing, that is, which amounts to compulsion, while distressing thought amounts to obsession. Both are there. So it is in these cases that ERP works better, and it's a definitive one. While CBT is a form of treatment which is in general given to many other anxiety and depressive disorders. Okay. So ERP specifically says about this particular scenario. That's the reason why ERP, given that option, ERP would be a best option. While systematic desensitization is used more often in phobias, wherein the person is made to prepare the hierarchy of anxiety provoking stimulus, and the least anxiety provoking stimulus is taken. And here the difference between this and ERP is that here the relaxation is taught to them in systematic desensitization. So all the anxiety provoking stimulus on being exposed, the patient is advised to have a relaxation technique followed. Okay. So that is not seen with ERP, wherein it is mostly focused on response prevention and experiencing the mounting anxiety. Okay, that's the difference between systematic desensitization and exposure and response prevention. Okay, so in these sort of confusions, just think of what specifically answers the scenario or the question here, and then choose the one. Okay. And DBT is dialectical behavioral therapy. Okay. Right. So we are almost coming to the end of session now. So last topic I thought was of dissociative disorders. Okay. This is a simple question. Labile indifference is seen in. This is a simple question with, hopefully most of the students will get it. Labile indifference is seen in conversion disorder, or otherwise referred to as dissociative disorder. Yeah. So ICD-11 mentions that conversion disorders are part of dissociative disorders, while DSM-5, it considers conversion and dissociative disorders as different. Okay. The labile indifference is nothing but, it's the kind of a odd indifference, though the severity of the symptoms seem to be so, like, for example, paralysis or blindness. Okay. So they are not too much worried about it, or they are indifferent towards it. It is that sort of a indifference is referred to as labile indifference, which is classically seen with dissociative disorders. Okay. So just a few points here with regard to dissociative disorders. Okay. So if any kind of a case scenario is given, okay, there are 3 points that has to be established here for making a kind of confident diagnosis here. Either complete or partial loss of like awareness, memory, identity, motor or sensory control. Okay. So there should be a complete or partial loss. For example, if a person says that he was not aware for that particular period, he has lost his memory towards it. So that is complete. while partially he remembers some of the things. So both can be a requisite job. And identity. So this is typical of a fugue state, wherein the person doesn't remember his own identity. He says, like, ask questions like, who am I, kind of a thing, right? So that is loss of identity. Or motor or sensory control. So we usually claim our voluntary control over all these things: memory, identity, motor, or sensory. So whatever we do motorically or sensory, whatever we pursue, we claim control over it, right? So when it gets dissociated, that's what the term is, in terms of complete or partial loss. So there should be that criteria. That's one. Then there should be no physical evidence to explain this loss. For example, somebody has got head injury because of which he doesn't remember particular period of the accident or before that, 1 or 2 hours before that. So that doesn't become a dissociative disorder. Okay. Or somebody has a retinal artery or retinal vein occlusion, wherein because of which they have a temporary blindness. Okay. So that is not referred to as dissociative. So there shouldn't be any physical evidence to explain the set of symptoms they present with. And lastly, there should be a temporal relationship with occurrence of symptoms. For example, somebody was lost his or her mother, following which he comes up with, there was a question in INICET wherein a girl has complaints of blindness following her mother's death after about 1 or 2 weeks. Okay. So there is a temporal association between the event, triggering event, and occurrence of the symptoms. Okay. So there should be psychological stressors. Okay. When these three are there, then a dissociative disorder is diagnosed. Okay. So under which, again, there are dissociative fugue, you have dissociative anesthesia, you have dissociative identity disorder. Okay. Also, you have, based on what is involved, dissociative seizures. Okay. And there is one other controversial element which gets added here, is that multiple personality disorder, though it's a controversial. Okay. So these are the various dissociative disorders. Okay. Depending on the what is completely or partially lost. Okay. So we have covered the high yield topics like psychopharmacology, we have covered substance use disorders, we have covered psychopathology, basics in mental health, we have covered OCD, dissociative disorders. So hope the session was useful to you.